God, your favor has allowed the Dear Future Wifey podcast to be the first of its kind.
Oh my God.
The first to be booked by churches.
How y'all doing, Word of Truth Church?
The Bible says that God is not the author of confusion. So I ought to know exactly where I stand with you.
The first to be booked internationally.
Now we try to please the world versus the word.
You said we try to please the world and not the word.
Yeah.
And the difference is just an L.
That's right. That's right.
And you take an L when you try to please
the
word.
Come on. Come on. That's it.
The first to be booked at a major award show.
I think so often when we hear that idea of love or someone says, I love you, they say it in the word, but you can't see it anywhere in the deed.
You are using this podcast to heal countries.
I will use my story to steer other young men away from the road and the path that I took.
Thank you for transforming my pain into a beautiful platform.
Welcome to the Dear Future Wifey Podcast. I'm your host, LaTerra Star Whitfield. How are y'all doing? IBOC is in the building. Hold on. Are you still shacking up with us? If you're still shacking up with us, can we get a commitment? Hit that subscription button and subscribe. Make sure you turn on your notification bell so you'll be notified about upcoming episodes. Make sure you join our mailing list. The link is in the description. This is a very special day for me. I'm at the church that I gave my life to Christ at when I was 18 years old. The year was 1996. So if I break down crying sometime during this interview, just understand I'm amongst praisers in the place. And so I'm at home, y'all. I'm at home. This will be my most sentimental episode. The episode that touches my heart on levels that people won't even be able to imagine. I don't take this lightly. As y'all know, to have Sister Beverly Rush with a microphone in front of her face couldn't be nobody but God. Come on, somebody. And so I'm so excited. So I have an agenda today. My agenda for this episode is to introduce and reintroduce Pastor Rush and Sister Beverly Rush on a level that y'all have never been able to hear them speak on ever before in the history of the 34 years of this amazing ministry. I've been able to sit at their feet and glean some insights where Pastor Rush was just sharing things with me that really gave me a level of understanding about why he is the way he is. And it touched me on a very deep level. And my agenda today is for that to resonate with everyone in this building and for those that are watching online and those that will be watching this episode on my podcast. I pray that this episode heals your heart. I pray that this episode delivers you from any animosity, any anger, anything that you're withholding. I ask that you lay it on the altar today. Lay it on the altar today. And so I'm excited about this episode. So without further ado, welcome to the Dear Future Wifey Podcast. My homies, Pastor Ricky G. Rush and Sister Beverly Rush, put your hands together.
To God be all the glory.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah. To God be all the glory.
So I had to try to put some gum in my mouth real quick. So I'm so excited to have y'all on the podcast today. It's so amazing to have y'all because in the 34.
Are you chewing gum on
this? Huh? What's wrong with that?
I thought nothing. Security.
Oh, what? Oh, my bad. Okay. Oh. Some things have never changed, huh? Something.
Okay, now let's keep going. Thank you for having us.
Man, y'all just gonna take my gum away from me? Things have never changed. So why is that such a? I remember inviting. She's my ex-wife now, but when I was dating her, she came and she was chewing some gum, and she was highly offended when the usher told her to remove her gum. Why is that the code of ethics at the Inspired Body of Christ Church?
Well, because it was the wrong flavor gum. No, it was not spearmint.
Oh, no, it's going to be like that the whole day, folks.
No, what happened was, you know, sometimes, and let's talk, y'all, this is going to be, we don't know what he's going to ask.
Right.
So it's our church, and if you got to go early, God bless you, thank you, but we're going to talk.
Yeah.
Let me talk about that. I love gum more than anybody. I especially love people sitting next to me chewing gum. You'll get it later. But sometimes in a church, when people are chewing gum, you know, people waste gum. We are a praising church. And we know all about form and all of that. We're a very dignified, classy church with a lot of class, as you can tell Sister Rush here with us. A lot of class in this church. But sometimes people drop gum. Gum gets in seats. People come later, sit in those seats, get gum on their dresses. Those people get extremely offended. Sometimes with children, they wipe gum on seats and things. And when people spend money for their clothes, they bring us the cleaner bills because they get them from here. And then it becomes a permanent mark in the chairs. So it's nothing spiritual, nothing about going to hell. It's just that gum sticks on chairs and sometimes we don't get to see it. And it comes off on other people. And some visitors get offended. We have to find another way to do it. So what we do now is we don't just take gum. We offer them a mint. Because I think they have gum because they meant to talk to people. So rule number one, if someone offers you a mint, never say no. Just take it.
Listen, one of the things that I used to be very envious of when I watched you preach is you will always have a glass of orange juice with a little napkin. Can somebody bring me some orange juice? Because if I'm going to be on the stage, it's some of the simple things. I used to be watching you on stage, and I'd be like, that orange juice, is it just me? Or did y'all look at that orange juice and be like, man, I want a sip of that?
Yeah.
So since I'm on, you too, sister?
I wanted it.
Mm-hmm. So thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. You orange juice?
Yeah. Yes, this right here means the world to me.
You are Pastor Rush in full effect today.
Yeah, you would literally have orange juice on the stage, and so I'm going to make all of them get envious.
Oh, man. It looks like my glass, too.
Yeah, your glass.
You know what, before we start this, I want to tell you how much we appreciate you.
We
want to say that. I'm going to speak for us. Mr. Rush will definitely speak for herself. But I want to say more than anything, this is probably the most sincere moment I'll have, one of the most sincere moments I'll have. Is when our church went through a crazy crisis. We deserve crisis, all churches do. But what affected me the most was a story, an article that I read. And then after that, my daughter, who was very good at doing what she did, she started working, and the people that were with her kind of released her because of the name of what, you know, they couldn't understand the association that the church was going through. And all of the friends that she had made and associations she had built and relationships, you know, I'm never going to let my daughter ever, or grandson, or even members of our church, and my wife and all, we're never going to be without. I will go without anything.
Amen.
Before
Amen.
I let the people around me be without. But she, no one would really actually hire her. And you took a chance with her and gave her a chance to work with you. And she has been behind the scenes doing a lot of your thing. And we're here because we want to say thank you for helping us with our
thank
baby.
Thank you.
And she's not a baby. She's a grown woman.
Yeah.
But that is the real reason that I said, okay, let's do this. Because when my daughter has suggested some things, I said no a lot. Think it through. And when this came to be, the first thing I wanted to say was thanks, man, for offering our daughter an income and a chance to go into her career and be not be shamed and be bold and for helping her to do that. Thank you. That's
thank
why
you,
we're
thank
here.
Thank you for raising an amazing young queen. So shout out to Christian. Christian, stand up. She's single. She told me to tell everybody she's still single. So she's looking for a husband. So this is the Dear Future Wifey podcast, so, you know, she's looking for a husband, so. Any takers out there, any takers, is there one, is there? Listen, one of the things that I admire, a lot of times that we're just going to back up. We're going to back up to, how did you and Sister Rush meet?
Okay. We're going to put some prayers in some buckets. No, it was, I can give my version of it. I was at church. Yes. I was not looking for Sister Rush, okay? She was looking for me.
No, so. No, I wasn't. No, I wasn't.
Okay,
I was not looking for him.
Jerry, no. Jerry.
Just not.
Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot this is, people are saying this all over the world. Okay, I'm gonna be serious just one more time again, then I'm gonna go back. No, I was actually doing revivals. I was at a church preaching and I saw her sisters. I never saw her. She had like five sisters. And she was in the back of a church. They were in the back of a church and they brought her to church one day. And all they did was they said, "These are our sisters." And they showed me a picture and I said, "Wow, look at that one right there." And she was the sister in the middle. And I said, "Is she here?" And they said, "No." And I was not in the flesh.
You wasn't.
We rebuked
you. I'm going to tell you the real story in a minute.
But you looked at the picture and said, "Where is she?"
Right.
But you wasn't in the flesh.
And then.
You saw the Spirit of God in the picture.
And it was like a Christian song. It kept going, "Angel," like that. And I'm like, "What is this?" No, but really, she came to church and we just. And it's just like that. It happened just at a church in a revival, just talking and.
So when she came to the revival the next day, let me ask you.
Yes, and every day after that,
I did.
Sister Rush,
she
what
kept
happened?
Coming back.
I did. My sisters had been telling me there's this minister that can really preach. Not only does he preach, but he teaches. You learn so much. And I'm going, okay, you know, I'm gonna give him a try. See what he's teaching. You know, because you know I've been in ministry in all my life. So I did go. I went with my sisters, and this man was teaching. I mean, I learned so much in one service. I'm going, man, I've been in ministry all my whole life. My dad's a preacher. I thought I knew it all, you know. But he taught so much, and I was like, wow. Talking about admiration. I just thought that was just so amazing that I was learning so much. So I did. I kept coming.
So it's the word of God that drew you to him.
Yes. We got signals up here.
Yeah, we're going to have some signals up here.
So how did y'all go on your first date? How did it go from you hearing this man of God preach and teach you so much that in that one sermon than you learned in your whole Christian walk? How did it go from that to going on a date?
Well, you know, after I think it was like that last Friday of the, you know, it was just a whole week of revival. And after that, I think it was like that Friday, he waited, the church started clearing out, and he called us up to the front, you know, me and all my sisters, because I wasn't going anywhere without my sisters. So me and my sisters went forward, and he started talking, and he was, I noticed, I'm going, he's so shy. He looked so boldly up in
Pastor
that.
Russ pole. Shy?
Yeah.
He was shy at a point in his life?
Yes, he's just messing with his little feet and stuff. And I'm going, this man is shy. He couldn't even look at me in my face. So he asked, you know, would I go out somewhere with him? I'm going, sure, but all of my siblings have to go.
And how many was it?
It was six of us.
So he had to treat all y'all out on the date.
And my mother.
And your mama.
And my mother.
Every time we went somewhere, since we're on the subject, I had to buy a van. I had a Camaro.
A whole month.
Had to get a dart bus to take y'all out.
A whole month.
This one time, so our first date, for real date, was horseback riding, you know, because I had horses, and it wasn't intended to be horseback riding. She just, what the kind of stuff do you do? And I like to ride horses, so we wanted to go riding horses, riding my horses, and
you had horses back then.
Yeah, that was when I was like 25 years old. We were very young, 24, 20 something. I was like, we were kids.
Yeah.
Well, whatever that means. So, but the funny part is we did. We went riding the horses, and it was so, I was trying to be a gentleman, but I couldn't be a gentleman with, like, she and I on a horse, and all, her mom and all the people walking behind us. I'm like, this is jacked up. This is not good. But I did. I kept trying to make the horse go fast, and then the family just fell out, and I don't think they want to come. It was bad. That's the truth.
So what did you think about that? Was there a romantic connection when you saw him preach, or did it kind of grow over a period of time?
No, it had to grow over a period of time. I wasn't looking for anyone. You know, I knew who I was.
How old were you at this time?
I was 24.
You're 24.
I was 24 and he was 25. Yes, because we got married when I turned 25. And he was 26.
Okay. She said she wasn't looking for nobody,
but looking.
God sure expedited that plan, didn't he?
Yeah. I wasn't looking. That was nothing but the Lord.
So Pastor Russ, where were you looking? When you saw her on that photo, what did you see her as?
If I'm not gonna cry on this, but this is where this gets a little different for me. And sometimes people wonder, I heard you told me that people say, wow, nobody knows who Pastor Rush's wife is. And rumors, he keeps her hidden. And I didn't keep my wife hidden, I kept her protected. Because I had already experienced what it means to have a gun by your side that scares people, but is not loaded. And it's like you can fake people out with blanks, or you can take people out with bullets. So this is the story, and this is one of the reasons I decided that it was time. I read this incredible. I felt like God owed me something. Let me just start there. This was not a romantic encounter. When you build your relationships on romance, it seems that publicly people want to know what you do. And once they figure out what you do, they want to add techniques on how you do what you do. But if they don't know what you do, they have to discover who you are.
Mm.
And once they discover who you are, they realize we can't do what he does unless we are who he is.
Teach.
So God owed me something. And let me get it. I read an article in a paper that said my mother died. Before my mother died, she was attacked, okay? Everybody listen. But when my mother died, I didn't know why my mother was sick. My mother was attacked. I watched my mother get attacked. My mother lost her life. I was very angry with God. I read an article that said, I lied about that. I promise you, of all the lies I've ever told, I wish that was a lie. But after that happened, I didn't have a cheerleader. I wasn't looking for love anymore. That's why I was so sincere in God. I needed to have something every day of my life to fill a void. My mother was gone, but my life did not stop. And I thought that was unfair, because when you lose who's supporting you, you're supposed to stop wanting to be something.
Teach.
So it's unfair, because I wasn't looking for a wife, but God knew that I was gonna need a cheerleader or a coach for where he was taking me. I did not ask, and I'm sorry, this doesn't have the whole romantic flair that everybody may think. I did not ask God, send me a wife. No, I asked God to help me be strong. And he had me preaching at a time that I didn't like him. And so after my mom died, I went those years not trying to replace her, just trying to find out who I was. And when I saw Sister Rush, I was not looking for a wife. I was trying to find someone seriously who could play the role of a mother to whatever God would send me. And I told her, I'm a preacher, but I'm not gonna pastor a church. That is not my desire in life. So it wasn't like, you know, a lot of people say, well, you have to have a wife, and if you're going to validate. No, I enjoyed being a boy, a young man, a man of God, a genuine man. And when we met, I felt like, okay, God, is this where you're telling me that you're going to put someone in my life that would be nurturing like a mother, but wonderful like a friend, and fruit-bearing like a wife? And I knew it's just not natural, not real for you to have a child with your mother, but you never stop being your mother's child, and you never stop wanting a mother around. And so God says, you know, to my heart, don't go looking. Just don't stop watching. And that's really, I mean, of all the things that I wish that people would, that hurt probably me the most, is that someone would not understand that God didn't take my mom, but God had to, at some point, use my mother's death to help me appreciate the value of all women. At some point, sometimes men are asking, how can I be the best wife, best husband? And I don't think that's a requirement for you to be the best husband. I think you have to make her the best wife she could ever imagine being, even if you fall short of being the best husband.
And that's, you better teach. You better teach.
That's how it happened, and that's it.
So back on when you pointed out her out of the group of the women, what made you point her out? Because I... She had all these sisters. You pointed at her and said, who is she?
See, I got to be careful because y'all heard the story of Cinderella. I mean, it's just what, you know,
Okay.
No, I don't. Let me say this. Any one of them could have been her.
But you chose one.
They just didn't have no taste. No, I'm silly. No, they because they were all friends like that, but again, I wasn't, and I know this won't, it might make somebody's headlines, but it's not like I could say, ooh, there was a glow, and that was, it wasn't that, because that could have been any woman.
I know it wasn't that, but you pointed her out, though.
Yeah.
That's what I mean, so it's like, there was a moment that happened to where you saw her in the midst of everyone. And that's what happens anytime a man decides to marry a woman. Mm-hmm. He's dating all these different women, and then he looks at one and says, that's my wife. Mm-hmm. And it's a saying that says, when you know, you know. So it was something about her in that moment at 25 years old that you identified her from a portrait, and then you made the necessary steps to go horseback riding with this one woman while her family was in tow. So it was something about it. I know you're not saying it's something all romantic, but there was a Kairos moment that happened in that moment where you saw her in the midst of everybody else.
In the place of that picture?
Yes.
She was hidden, but still seen. There were five girls in that picture.
Yeah.
And if you just allow me. So it's like,
you gotta get the microphone, Pastor Rush.
No. Oh.
So like, I couldn't see her. She wasn't hiding in the picture. She wasn't trying to be seen in the photograph.
Yeah.
I had to see the one who didn't need the spotlight to be noticed. So, I'm serious. And so, if you're trying to be seen, you're gonna be seen and forgotten. If you're not seen, you're going to be noticed and sought. So she, to me, was not trying to be seen. It made me look. Now remember, all I was looking for was, I wasn't looking for a wife. I just wanted somebody to be, I hate to say a mother, because see, that's not fair. That means that everybody has this role to play. She didn't have a role to play. She had a person to be. And I didn't know if in my life I needed to have somebody in the front seat with me, in the driver's seat with me. It's okay to be in the front seat, but there are two front seats.
Yes.
And she wasn't fighting for a place on the picture. And so she wasn't fighting for a place in my life. I had to seek what I thought I wanted to see. Not know, I just wanted to see.
Teach.
And once I saw, I grew to know, and 37 years later, I'm still seeking to know. I don't know her like that. 38 years.
38.
No, but two of those years we were separated. Don't miss me. See, people like to hear stuff like that. You gotta
No.
That's never happened. But yeah, so it's been 38 years. Man, quit. But yeah, that's how that's.
But that makes a whole lot of sense. That's the reason why I wanted you to unpack that more. Yeah. It's because it gives framework for women. I always say this quote that God gave me: men should pursue and not persuade, and a woman should present and not pursue.
Yes. Yes.
And so in that seeing phase, all she has to be is who she is, full of her glory, full of her essence, and the right man will recognize who she is to him. So she doesn't have, and like she said, she was in the same heart posture as you were. She said she wasn't trying to look for a man. She was just existing in her full glory. She was confident in who she was. And so when did the switch click for you, Sister Rush?
When did
you start seeing him, not just as your friend, but as a potential love interest?
As I continued to go to different revivals and hear him teach and preach, and I was able to observe how he treated the people. He had genuine love. He was kind to everybody, and I loved that. I thought, okay, you know, he wasn't standoffish, you know. So that caught my eye. And that's dear to my heart because I love people. I love people. So that was one thing that got me, was how he treated other people. And then it was also how he started treating me. I was like, okay.
What did he do? What did he do, Sister Russ?
You know, he...
What was the first thing he did to you where you was like, he's different?
He cooked for me.
What?
He cooked for me.
TV dinner.
No, it was some red beans and ground meat. Yeah, cornbread. Yes.
Oh, so you was cooking.
He was cooking.
That was Bernie, man. That was great.
So he cooked you dinner as a date.
Yes.
And it was good.
It was good. I wasn't the kind of lady that liked to just go out different places. You know, take me on a picnic. I'm good. You know, I don't have to go to a big fancy restaurant. No, take me out to them horses and let's have fun. You know, that's me. You know, and I wasn't getting that from others, but with him, I got, okay, now this is me. I get to be me, and I loved it. I just loved it.
And so, how long did it take for y'all to become official? Because y'all got married in a year. So,
no, it was 2 years.
2 years.
No, it wasn't.
It was 2 years.
It was not.
Well, I wasn't.
It was
there.
1 year.
He wasn't there.
Was it a year for real?
Yeah.
Wow.
It was barely a year.
Pastor Rush, you don't recall that? You don't recall it?
Not that fast.
Yeah.
So what happened? So when did you decide to propose to her? What happened? What was that click moment for you to say, this is the woman I believe? Was it that you believe God called her to be your wife, or was it you wanted her to be your wife?
Well, I knew that would be the only way to get rid of her mama and her sisters. I mean, hey, we're on TV.
Wave at the people.
I said, I can fix this. No, I of course I wanted to do things and be decent and in order.
Right.
I wasn't a pastor. When we married, and I wasn't. I was still struggling with God. If I really opened myself up to someone now, are you going to take this one too? See, I was. It was a lot of that.
That's good,
and
though.
And it wasn't fair to her as a wife or going to be a wife to not express that. I mean, it was. I think it was unfair to say to her, you know, to fake this proposed life that I'm never going to pastor people, because around me when we dated, and one of the things that we were saying is there. Notice she said week after week, every week of my life, I was moving somewhere, I was traveling, I was preaching. I mean, and so I never belonged to her. Mm-hmm. Okay, I belonged to him, mm-hmm. and I never claimed her. I just noticed that she never denied him. So
hold on, you gotta let that settle. Jesus,
no. Okay. When your woman has a man that's stronger than you,
yeah.
you got to stay connected with her man too. See? Because maybe he will teach you how to, I can't be to her what he is to her. And so sometimes people wonder, why don't we see your wife in church and sitting with you? She doesn't come to see me. When she first met me, she didn't come to see me. She came to hear from him. And the best way for her, I think, I'm not speaking for her, I'm just going with what she said. The best way to stay focused on him is to make him the center of attention and not let her become the major distraction. Because those people you love can be the ones that can hurt you. And if people know where you hurt, they attack that. My marriage vow said to love and protect, not to show and tell. So so if we're different, I'm just different. And it bothered me when people think, where is she, where is she, where is she? And I say, pick her. Because she is a reflection of everybody you see in our church. Where's Pastor Rush? Pick him. He's a reflection of every man you see in this church. So this may end some kind of a weird romantic story, but I think if you're going to tell the truth about God's love instead of using God as an excuse for your lust, then, you know, if the truth be told, somebody may ask, well, why is she here now? Because now, 38 years longer later, she's wiser, stronger, and can fight for herself.
Woo! Yes. Yeah, that's it.
And she doesn't need my name. She just needs my support. I have never fought for her. I've watched her deny fighting to show me that what I teach is working. She still has the same man in her corner that made me look at her on a picture. He hasn't faded. He hasn't failed her. He hasn't turned away from her. If anybody has changed, it's been me. Her God never has. So when I try to figure out how to deal with her, I talk to him and he may say, leave her alone. She's still mine.
See?
So a lot of people marry and they go for the finished product and I'm still in production. he's still working on me.
Is this blessing y'all? Cause yeah. I'm about to lay on this floor, but I'm trying to. And that's what I was telling Pastor Russ, just in conversation with him. I was like, do you realize what you're saying? He was like, I don't know. I mean, he acts like he don't realize these gems that you're dropping, and it's transforming the way I even view marriage, the way I view a wife. And so I honor you, man of God, for the lived experience that you have that is going to transform the lives of the people that are watching this episode, the people that are in this sanctuary, is giving brevity to what marriage really is and these vows that we take. And so you got married to her, you were about 26, where we agree you was about 26. I know it's a little discrepancy there.
Yeah.
So you're about 26 at that time, she was about 25. Let's take a look at your wedding photo. Look at that right there. So how old were you then, Pastor Rush? When you look at that, how old do you see yourself at that moment?
I really don't know. I think I was the church. I evaluate things by churches. So I remember where the wedding was. I was probably about 26, 27 maybe.
And what church was that when you said the church?
It was Pilgrim Valley Baptist Church in Fort Worth. We had to get married close to where she lived. It played out to the last minute. I mean, and all her family came, and her mother, and her father did the wedding.
Her father officiated.
Yeah.
And then her mom, as beautiful as things are, which is why you have to be careful about when you go into marriage and all of these vows. that we make, her mother, bless her wonderful heart, had an illness that came upon her body. And so she ended up living with us, I think, how many years? 8 years, maybe?
Oh my
God. Let's just say 8, just to be safe so I can win. But she came to live with us for 8 years. And during that time is when I honestly realized that's why I couldn't call her just my wife. She was God's vessel, because I'd never had to live with someone every day of my life whose 100% attention had to be on nurturing the person who caused her to be the woman she was.
Yeah.
You don't marry for your mother-in-law to live in your house. You just don't imagine that.
Yeah.
You don't. But when it happens, it doesn't bring out who you are as a man. It shows you who that person is as a woman. And then you think, if I accidentally fell and bumped my head.
Yes.
If I was on life support, would she say, he wouldn't want to suffer? Because that's where that insurance check come in, you know. And so I'm like, yes, I do. I'm going to suffer for 5 years. But no, so it gets like that. It gets to where then you realize again, there she was in the background.
Yes.
So someone could say, well, who's taking care of Mother Jackson? And who's that? And she never raised her hand and raised a flag. And I'm doing this and y'all not doing that. She stayed in the back of that picture. And so instead of being glorified for doing all the right things for her mom, she had to do what my mom did. And I've never spoken this out of my mouth. My mom was sacrificed so I could live. She sacrificed a lot with her mom every day so that her mom would have a chance at a different life. My mom was sacrificed, and that's why I'm the kind of person that I am. Because my mom, the night my mom was attacked, and all of my relatives and family is like, why didn't you tell anybody? Cause it ain't nobody, wasn't anybody's business. Poor people sacrifice their spouses in order to protect their lives. And I don't think that we should sacrifice people to make us look popular. I think if a person chooses to sacrifice themselves, they don't care if they're popular. They accomplish their goal. And I would never sacrifice another human. I don't throw my daughter out for people to see who my daughter is. I don't throw my grandson out. I just don't think that that's fair, that you get sacrificed because of who God sent you. I don't sacrifice her, Christian, I mean, or Beverly, or my grandson. Now, we know Christian, she'll sacrifice herself. She just, so that's a whole nother podcast.
That's a whole nother episode. Up.
You know, so I'm trying not to give her the side eye right now. But no, sometimes people, well, they gotta know who she is. No, she's gotta know who she is. They may never approve. And even, what does their approval mean?
There it is.
And, you know, if I tell you the fastest way to get a divorce is next Sunday, I put her up in one of these chairs beside me with a hat on, it's over. It's over.
Why you say that?
And, you know, because that's just not who we are. That's right. For some people, but that's not for everyone. Some people in here drive Fords. Some people drive Chevys. Some people drive Lexus. Some people drive Mercedes. That's just not for everyone.
And so let me tell you what's so interesting about that, because when I was a member here, I used to feel like you said, which I shared with you, is that she was always hidden, until I realized that, Sister Rush, you don't want to be in the spotlight. So I want you to share from your mouth, why is it that you don't want your seat in the church on stage with a church hat on? Why is it that you don't want to have Women's Day at the church where you're up there and you're leading a ministry? Why is that?
For the fact that I watched my mother. My mother and my dad had a ministry in Fort Worth. And my dad was the pastor. And I watched how my mom, she worked behind the scenes. She didn't have to be up front to get things done. And I was able to grow and to learn that you don't have to be seen. So that was just something that was instilled in me, just watching my mother. No, I do not like to be up front. No, I don't mind if you acknowledge me every now and then. It's okay. It is okay. But no, I do not like being up front. I like my one-on-one with all my beautiful sisters here. We have some amazing women here. Give me my one-on-one time. No, I don't have to be up front. I do not like it.
And to that credit, listen, man. I like having fun with people. I just refuse to be sad any day if I can. And I'm not going to talk about the conflicts we have, but one of the major conflicts we've had is when I would say something in church that I thought was really funny that was about, you know, well, you know, my wife the other day wasted a potato on the couch or something silly like that. And I thought it was so funny, and I would go home, and you know that. And I'm like, what? You know, it's like, because what people don't know about me that she will attest to my daughter. See, I'm a 100% seems like introvert. I don't talk. I'm probably the quietest person that people ever know. They would know. And public, you would think she never says a word.
Right.
She's just the opposite.
Right.
She talks all the time. And people think I'm a good listener. I've been forced into this. Y'all, you know people get those signals online. If something's wrong, give a wink. I'm in trouble. No, so I would try that. You know, the preacher would come up, tell a bunch of wife stories, and my wife and I, and she just didn't like that. Because sometimes people take those stories, and, you know, I like to make illustrations. They're called lies, but you know, but you tell stories just for fun.
Yeah.
But it didn't take me long, and it really affected me once my grandson started at this age. Because I'll tell a grandson story, he's like, "Pappy, that was between me and you." And I thought, but it was so funny. And then I realized, whoa.
Yeah.
So she's seems to be hidden, but she's still in the picture.
Mm.
And sometimes, and I've said before, I could get a little nervous because I know I got a different evaluation. My mother never heard me preach, but I think if she hear me preach, she would rip my sermon apart. And sometimes I have to be very careful because if I say something wrong here, somebody can go and, you know, gossip or say something to each other. But if I say something, then you go home, it's like, so now you're gonna say Matthew was a girl? And I'm like, I didn't say that. Yes, you did. So you have to be, you know, you have to be accountable for what you teach. She never stopped being a student of the gospel, and I never stopped being a pastor.
Yeah. That's good. So you never saw the vision of becoming a pastor. And so take us back to the very first church, the first place that you held service at. And let's show that on the screen, the first flyer that went out. There it is. This is the first flyer.
This is when I was doing my Michael Jackson off the wall auditions. No, I knew that I was going to pastor a church. I knew that that was going to happen.
But at first, when you met her, you said that you wasn't trying to do that.
I was not going to.
So when did it switch?
It didn't switch. I just hadn't finished running my race, which is why it's horrible for people to predict what you're going to do if you live by faith. You shouldn't do that, because I was committed to being what I told her I would never do.
Right.
But she, to me, had to be committed to saying, this is between you and God. There are things that I just didn't see coming. And we couldn't afford it. We could not afford a church. I was working in a school, I was working hours. She was working at the Kaiser office. I didn't have time for work. I didn't have time for school. I didn't have time for church, and I didn't have time for family all of a sudden. And I didn't have time to still get past my grief. And so I had five things going at one time. And I don't think I needed a wife. I think I needed a friend. And then I remembered her friend, Jesus, God. And I thought the best thing to do is go and let her know that I'm now continuing another relationship with the friend that made me see her. Mm-hmm. Instead of saying all these other things and making them seem phony. Mm-hmm. And she just waited. She just waited and she checked it out. And she knew that I did not know what I was doing. But she did know that I was trusting God. And if God was wrong about this, maybe God could have been wrong about her.
So let's ask that. Hold on, Sister Russell. Was the weight that heavy for you when he says, so you're a career woman, you're working, he's working, and he comes to you and said that God is basically calling him to start a church? What was your first thought? Being a PK, being a preacher's kid, what was your first thought?
Oh, my goodness. I thought, oh, no, I never wanted to be a pastor's wife. Because I knew what it encompassed.
Right.
I knew the time that it took away from the family, you know, the responsibility of being a pastor. And then this ministry, it just flourished so fast. And I'm like, oh my goodness. But no, I did not want to be a pastor's wife. And yeah. He did not want to be a pastor because he kept telling me, now, I never want to be a pastor. I love being an evangelist. I can just go and preach and go about my business. I don't have to tend to no flock. And, you know, and he just kept speaking. And I'm thinking in the back of my head, oh, no. I know something's coming. He's going to be pastoring. Oh, my goodness, Lord, why are you going to do this to me? But I tell you, I love it. I love ministry. Yeah. I now, love seeing people
say
grow.
That again, because there's a pastor's wife who's listening to that needs to hear you say that, because I hear all these messages and maybe that's what gets the most ratings, but I hear people, pastors that don't like the churches, pastors' wives who don't like the responsibilities, but say that again, you love it. And, yeah. And I'm not, I just think that needs to be repeated.
Totally.
Yeah, I love the ministry. I look, these ladies to me are my sisterhood. These are my sisters.
Yeah.
You know, now you know, I am not naive. I know everyone here is not for me. So, you know, we're not going to get that twisted.
Teach.
But I love these women. These are some amazing women in here. I love them. Love them. Love them.
You always say that. Like, even when I talk to you on the phone, I love the women that I bought. It's like, she's like, that's my sister. She'll go on and on about y'all. My goodness. You love them. That's your sisterhood, huh?
I love them.
Yeah,
yes.
That's powerful. And so what was that first service like, Pastor Rush, in Singing Hills?
It was interesting. I felt like if I got past that first service, it was going to be okay. And I didn't expect it to keep going. You know, it's you preach, people, hey, hallelujah, they fall out in the shout. And then you go on to the next thing. But this one now, the next thing, are the same people again. And you're looking at this lady, she's mad at you because you didn't come see her mom
right
in the hospital. And then I'm the old school preacher. I'm the one that I still believe, go to the hospital, go visit them in the home. As the lady said the other day, somebody tell me what's wrong, let's go visit them. Let's go. See, I'm old like that.
Let me share this with you, which I thought was my personal opinion. I believe that you overextend yourself, but that's you. And I'll say this because prior to your surgery, you literally, I came and visit the church, and you went to visit a woman in the hospital who was passing. And I said, Pastor Rush, how are you limping around trying to visit somebody else in the hospital? And you was like, this is just who I am. And you said that if I don't, try not to get emotional. You said, if something were to happen, the lady's not going to even think about the fact that I'm physically not in the best health to be seeing her mom. She's going to remember that I just didn't see her mom. And that was more important. Her need was far more important than your own physical need. Yeah. And when I say that's the heart of a pastor that a lot of people don't give props to. And so I just want to celebrate you because I saw that. And I said, why are you doing, like, why are you really doing this? And I videotaped the whole thing. We're driving down the street. We walking all through the hospital. And I was looking at you and I said, this man is really about the Father's business. Because you had every excuse in the world not to do it. And it would have been okay. It's okay for you not to have shown up. But because your dedication to the members of this church is what it is, you didn't make an excuse for it.
Yes.
And I saw you as a man do that. And that meant the world to me. So salute you, King.
And you have to look at it in different aspects. There are some people who come to you because of their personableness. But then those are the same people that will leave you because once they have what they want, you have no value to them. So it has to come from your heart. It can't come from your amens, your thank you, Jesuses, or your attendance. People that sometimes don't come back to the same church, you know, I'm slower now. I intentionally this morning was not able to start church faster. These men had to sing all of our, everything didn't come together. But I could not use how I felt as a reason to not. They were leaning on me, they're trusting. And they're my brotherhood, okay? And them as a
Bachman.
Yeah. And that started that. And so we have to stand up front like this. So sometimes people love you, and once they use you, they're done. And then they go to the next available person that can either be used or misused. So when people say, I'm used by God, I've just learned to take that, okay, that's okay. So whatever anyone to take away from me that could hurt me, he replenishes it, restores, and I keep moving. And that's what surprises some people, is that we keep being restored.
Good. And so, Singing Hills, do you remember the attendance of the first service?
Yeah.
How many?
Oh, gosh, probably, I know 62 people joined that first service. It was amazing. That first group of people were just like, so we sit around every week. And then I thought, let's have a service. And the only doors that were open were Brother Clifton Maxfield up there at Singing Hills Funeral Home. And, you know, Clifton's a mortician. He real quiet. Got the key. What y'all doing? So, you know, he was been my best buddy. And he let us in to have service. Now, remember, I didn't know how long it would go. It's like, do it for a minute, and then it's out. Churches don't stick around with the same pastor, by the way. 34 years, that's a long.
That's a long time.
That's not the same pastor.
Yeah.
And so that happened. And all of that, I have to go through every issue that's going to come to me as a man, period, as a woman, period, as a family, period, while ignoring that to take care of these people who may not appreciate it.
Yep.
And so I had to remember, did I make a vow to love and protect or to show and tell? I have to remember that. I made a vow to love and protect his house, and he would love and protect mine. So I couldn't get it twisted, and I still don't get it twisted. And I can't say that she's number one. She has to. A lot of guys, well, my wife's number one. I mean, that's cool. She can't say that I'm number one. I would have to say that.
Yes.
And that's not a cut on anybody's relationship.
It's the truth.
But sometimes people are spoken into situations that they have not proven. And
you gotta stop. You gotta let that settle. Good Lord. Say that one more time for the people in the back. Say that one more time.
In other words, the people in your life that are number one, you don't have to put a one on their shirt. They're looking at you going, I feel like I am so important that this person would drop anything except himself to make sure my life is complete. And that might be what she saw before she was able to see. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's the shadow of things to come. Mm-hmm. So if I changed now, I would Okay. I have that little ladder thing right there that we see. I don't know if you guys can see that. I use that as a teaching model all over the country to decide, okay, if that's Pastor Rush at the top, then is that Sister Rush at the bottom? And somebody would say, you don't put your wife at the bottom, you put her at the top. It depends on how strong she is. Some women have to have that attention all the time. And so if she's getting it, maybe she doesn't appreciate the strength of who's holding her up. Some men have to have that all the time. You can't stay up there all the time. You got to go up or down it. Now, that person in the middle, that's where you have to decide where you are. So I have to ask myself, when she pledged AKA, and I didn't know it, to talk about being hidden. The AKAs are like private when they pledge. So I didn't know she was pledging. And then she just told me one day, I'm pledging. I went, okay. I didn't even know what to say. I'm like, tell me some of y'all secrets. And I never knew anything about that. That was something she desired. So what did I have to do? I had to shift strengths. I had to be the person at the bottom of the ladder holding her while she was going through that pledging. Because for 30-something years of this church, I was pledging to IBOC, and she was holding my ladder. So I didn't have the right to say, you don't need to be doing that. If that's what it takes to prove to you that I support people here and give to them financially and whatever, just to make sure that I can, you know, maintain what it takes to be strong, then that's what this means. Who's holding you? Who's holding me? And that's what we mean when we talk about this church. This church is holding us. We don't have the right to be arrogant or think that we're top dog pastors. People are going to come. Churches are going to grow all around us. Every church around here that's great right now is great because it's got a piece of Ibach in it somewhere, I promise you. Yeah. We got seeds all over this world, including you.
Yeah. Totally. Yeah.
And
totally.
And so we just have to learn now. You play your role, and you're up here today, and you're down there tomorrow. If I'm down today, I'm gaining strength for what's next.
Teach. Mm-hmm. Teach. Teach. So, after the funeral home, what was the next church?
Oh, we bought a college campus. It's called Southern Bible Institute. So we went from the funeral home, and we had to hurry up and get out of the funeral home because we could not have any night services. I mean, people were so devoted to their church, but after 6 o'clock, it was like, nah, Pastor. And so we bought another building on Buckner. It was falling apart. We had 2 toilets in the main lobby.
Yep.
We had 4 services. I think we had 7:30, 9:30, 11:30, and 1:30 or something like that. And it kept growing because at some point people knew that they could meet the Lord there. Then I think it got a little twisted because they knew they could meet strong men there or strong women there. And then I asked God, Lord, help me now to understand what the purpose of this church is, because people will use you for different things. And that was our first men's choir doing the same thing they did today. So we did a tribute to them. You just got to go back and teach how you got there. And we started out in Buckner, and we went those services. And
listen, it was my senior year of high school. The year was 1996. If we back up to 1994, February the 11th, 1994, I was kicked out of Skyline High School for taking a gun to school. And I took it to school because I wanted to sell it. My brother was playing around with the gun and actually shot out the bathroom mirror at home. And so when my dad got home, he knew that my dad would make us get rid of it. So he told me to take it to school and sell it. So with my entrepreneurial studies and skills, I decided to go ahead and sell guns. And I was caught at Skyline High School for gun possession. And the thing that hurt me the most was, notice how I got kicked out February the 11th, but I would no longer be able to be a part of the Unlimited Choir. And at my freshman year, yeah, I was like, my freshman year, you couldn't be in the limited choir as a freshman. And so I was looking forward to it as a sophomore, and they would do the big Black History Choir in the month of February. And so I got kicked out about 2 weeks prior to the big performance. And I was at home, and here's this thug at home, sad because I couldn't be in the choir. Because if anybody knows, anybody from Skyline, anybody was a part, there y'all go, make some noise. That was the thing to be a part of. It was like, man, and what was so revolutionary in that time is that God used you to bring the word of God into the schools for that 1 month and allow, like, that would be kind of heard of right now. It'd be people, you know, protesting, why are they teaching the word of God? Because you didn't stop teaching the word of God. Yeah. And so you'll be teaching the word of God, and we'll be singing these faith-filled, spirit-filled songs at school. And people will break out shouting. Teenagers will break out catching the Holy Spirit. That was unheard of back then. I want y'all to understand what that was back then. And even then, I knew the gravity of that. Fast forward, 96, 2 years later, I was the woman that I was dating at the time. Wow. She was pregnant. Wow. I was sitting at the bus stop on South Buckner, and one of the members of the church drove by, and it was on Monday school, and said, "Hey, why don't you come to church?" I was like, my girlfriend who's pregnant is, you know, having false labor, so I have to show up. And she was like, "What you gonna do when you get there? It's false anyway. Come to church." I said, "Who are these weirdos trying to get me to go to church on a Monday?" And so I got in the car with her. You know, back then you'd just be getting in cars with folks right now that wouldn't be safe. But she had I bought bumper stickers, so it was safe. So I got in the car, went to church, and I was like, "Wow, this is powerful." That planted the seed. Fast forward. December the 22nd of 1996 was the day I walked down, and we're gonna show a video real quick, but this is what happened. The night before, I was celebrating my homeboy's birthday. It was December the 22nd. We were at Lakeside Club. Y'all remember Lakeside? Y'all ain't been saved all your life. Y'all know about Lakeside. So I was at Lakeside Club, and I was sitting in the club, and it's like everything started moving in slow motion. And it's like I started just seeing spirits over people's heads. And I was like, "What in the world is this?" And my friend at the time, Montre Bible, kept trying to invite me to come to church. He was like, come to IBOC. I was like, "Man, I don't want nothing to do with all that. I ain't finna go to church." And after I left that club that night, I called him up that morning because he would literally catch the bus to get to church. And so I said, "You don't have to catch the bus in the morning. I'm gonna pick you up." So I went and picked him up. We went to church, and here's a clip of December 22nd when I was just 18 years old. Play it, please.
We have a brother that's come this morning. Amen. Come here, man. Bring him in. Hold my hand. We're gonna do this morning. I want you to.
Savior, I thank you today for my new life. I will live for you and through you and because of you, starting right now. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. All right, now, thank you, Jesus. We have joined the church today, Brother Latera Smithfield, First Assembly of God. God bless you, church. Amen.
So there were many people that Jesus healed, but only a few came back and said, "Thank you." Yeah. Thank you, Pastor Rush. Mm. Thank you. Because I was just a wayward young man trying to figure out my life. And I remember what you said in that sermon. It was an analogy that you used where you said that you were having a conversation with Christian, and you asked Christian if her mom were to pass or something were to happen, what type of woman would she want you to marry? And she began to name all this stuff. And then you said, well, what if I were to pass? What type of man would you want your mom to remarry? And she said, nobody. I don't think that no one could replace you. And at that age, I knew that I was replaceable. I knew that I wasn't the type of man that couldn't easily be found on any street corner. And that challenged me as a man to become the type of man that was irreplaceable in my daughter's eyes. So thank you.
Thank you.
So thank you. So after IBOC was thriving, IBOC was blowing up, Forest Services, bumper stickers, billboards. IBOC was very revolutionary. For those that don't know, IBOC was on the cutting edge of marketing, even when Pastor Russ didn't even call it marketing. The first church that would advertise on dart buses,
yes.
You know, yes. Billboards everywhere, license plate. They thought that IBOC was a cult. How many of y'all remember that? Like, your family were like, you go to that cult? That old crazy man. They thought he was David Koresh or somebody. It was like you're going to have us take cyanide and just everybody just kill themselves. And it was so crazy because if you said you was going to IBOC, the first thing you would get is ridicule. You would get persecution just because you said that you were a member of the inspiring body of Christ.
Right.
Isn't that crazy?
Right.
To be a member of a faith-filled community where people, I had a friend that texted me today while they were in church and said, this has to be the most friendliest group of people I've ever met in church. Because IBOC is full of love and it's genuine.
Yeah.
And so give yourselves a round of applause for being those type of people.
Yes.
And so when you were at that stage, did it actually settle into you that you were like, hey, I was called to be a pastor?
Yeah, and I've never heard anybody say anything negative about IBOC. I was so focused. I was trying to get to the next service, not the next year. I live by faith. And I told a story the other day about like Tarzan. I wait until the next vine and I don't know. At that point, when the church started growing, I had to make sure of a thing. Sometimes you see churches and people swarm to them and they go, wow, everybody's coming to this church. And that's like even now, people, ooh, everybody's joining now. So people invite their people. And then I have to ask God, what's the, see, some things look like growth, but growth and swelling look the same. Growth and swelling. Every woman with a huge stomach is not pregnant. Somebody got injured and they're swollen. And somebody can go, oh, you're going to have a baby. Or somebody could be pregnant and something's growing in them. And I always ask God to help this church to grow. I didn't trip on the swelling. I know when it swells. You go to Six Flags, you got 13,000 people getting free tickets, eating hot dogs and riding. Ooh, we're growing. No, we're not. We're swelling. Mm-hmm. You got to look at that. Everybody that's in your fight will never be in your corner.
Facts.
You got
facts.
Muhammad Ali in that corner, Joe Frazier. You can't get it twisted and think that everybody that's cheering is cheering for you. Your opponent has people in that same arena.
Yes.
So you look back and you look a few years later and you go, so y'all had all this stuff in marriage. What happened? Oh, now I can say she was growing. Mm-hmm. Or I can look, you got a house, you got this, you got, that's swelling. Because at the end of the day, I don't care how big your house is, how many cars you have, you only drive one.
Yep.
You only live in one place of the house. So I have to look, and when I look at our man of God now, I look, see, this today was not swelling to me. Today was growth. When she talks about the women of God here, that's not swelling. You can get over events, and we're gonna talk about a conference later. You can do things like that. Those are things that swell, and they look wonderful. But what's attached? You have grown as a father, but there was a time when you swole up because you thought this is ultimate, but you survived after something was punched and leaked out. You continue to stay based and solid. And I had to come to that reality really quick. I don't count empty spaces because sometimes I have grown to learn that all it takes is one somebody to tell one untruth to someone who doesn't know your story. And then you got to come to the reality. Are they here to worship God, or are they here because they fall in love with the personality?
Teach.
I can teach people how to be great, but I have to teach them how to live when they're not great.
Mm.
I can pay someone's rent, or I can teach them how to maintain a job.
Teach.
I can have a bunch of marriage people together and teach them how to talk about the great days of marriage, or I can bring young couples together and teach them about what God says about one man, one woman, one relationship, you know, that kind of thing.
Right.
Where you build, and now your relationship is a reflection of all the people around you. And now people don't know who to attack because they don't know who's from you. But sometimes it takes one thing for someone to show their hand. And that's what we've learned about this ministry. It's inspiring.
Yes.
When I got out of the hospital after my surgery, I wanted to come to church. And I was not married to someone who says, you can do that anytime. Those people are going to kill you. It was like, y'all open the church. Because if he can't get there, he's going to commit to it. He'll kill himself.
Yeah.
You have to know how you grow.
Yeah.
There is still somebody that's in a picture out here who has to be recognized. Maybe it's the lady that we talked about earlier who talked about having a stroke and she couldn't sing today. But is it because she's not, because she's not dancing? Is she still in that picture?
Yeah.
There are people who will come to Sister Rush that I never know about, period. And I'm going to just say this for the record. We don't share church business. Because I'm still her pastor. There are some people. Can I?
Teach.
Okay, well, there are some people that have been in this church that I didn't like. I love them, but God, why did you send them here? All these churches.
Said, all these churches, they showed up here. Yeah.
And it was God showed me they had to gain strength to support whoever next.
Mm.
They were here because this is where they were going to learn it.
Good.
But we don't do that. I don't sit home and go, you know, I hate brother so-and-so and sister so-and-so. I have probably wanted to in the back of my mind, but I realized my heart of forgiveness will have that person back up front in ministry. Now you got a home fight and a church fight.
Yeah.
And we don't fight that fight. So. Right. As far as she sees, it's always loving, kind. Now she knows there are days when I'm not going to work. But that doesn't mean that I don't work. So it's never like that. And when a person is not up front, they have no one to take their other burden to. If she took the load of this church, she would walk away from me and Christian's life and Kaden.
Yeah.
Because that would be the only way to survive it.
Yeah.
But if you don't know, that person is sitting right up in his face and da-da-da-da-da. I know that. That's where my level of forgiveness is.
Teach.
But I can't walk away from what I don't like. I have to endure to continue to say, I have not always been the great man, but I've always been the right man.
That's so good. That's so good. Listen, we're going to speed through this. So when we move to the building across the street, take us back there. What made you decide and what happened where we transitioned to the church across the street?
As we started growing more attention. And you notice all these stories now. You notice I'm not telling the story of Sister Rush because, again, she's still in the picture.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if you're tuning in, well, where did she come in? She moved with us. Sometimes when pastors grow, maybe their families and spouses quit.
Yes.
It's too much.
Yeah.
And not that it's too much, they're not encouraged the right way. I thank God that her parents went before us or her to show her.
Yes.
That's what that is. And I didn't ever try to be her father or her mother or that church. I didn't. That was great. But it was how she grew. And so she wasn't impressed with the swell. So we moved there and we started doing K-104. I was broadcasting on a radio station that I did not want to broadcast on, and then I was doing this Flavor TV episode and met a lady in here, I think last night, that said, we met in prison. I ain't been to no, what's wrong with you? But, you know, I started
she saw
all
you in prison.
Of that stuff, and I had a broadcast on the Channel 8 of every Sunday morning for 8 years I was doing that. There were a lot of opportunities to do what we call podcasts now. I was just inspiring people and taking advantage of it, not letting go to my head, trying to write books, trying to share people how to live by faith now and not how to live at IBOP. And that became very difficult because the cult thing happens when people think, they're just not used to people loving their church. People used to, you know, right. Come around and say, I love my pastor, I love my church. That sounds weird.
Yep.
You're supposed to hate the preacher and I'll hate going to church. And this church did just the opposite.
Exactly.
And then trained the world that it was okay to say that.
Yeah.
And people started calling it a cult. And we're so stupid in love with Jesus, we didn't care. Whatever that, we're not a cult, whatever that is. But we know why we love church and why we love the Lord and why we pour into them that love. We never ask for pastor's wife anniversary. All those things.
Yeah.
Never.
I want to touch on this, which was so interesting, because I've been behind the scenes with a lot of ministries and churches. One of the things that I applaud you as is that I applaud you for is you're the first pastor I ever heard, even when we were transitioning to the church across the street. You know, most times when pastors taking up offering, they say we need a building fund, we need to do X, Y, Z. You're the first pastor I've ever heard tell people if they're not in a position financially to give, this is not their season to give. I have never heard that in my life. And the reason why that's so important is because a lot of people dealt with such church hurt because a lot of churches will guilt you into giving to the house of the Lord. But then 2 weeks later, they're saying, hey, can you help me? I just got evicted, which has not been a good steward over your finances. Why did you have that heart posture to move like that?
Because someone was still in the picture watching. When your life is limited to only loving a certain kind of person, then you're no longer a reflection of the people that are going to benefit from that. So if it's not your season to give, now it's our season, my season, to give to you, to show the love of Christ. I will not lose my class or the dignity of being a Christian because times change. He doesn't change. So we're going to do offering here in a minute. Somebody may not be able to give. They already gave a prayer. So I believe that if you give God something to work with, he's going to do that. And as a result, we have been a church for 34 years and we have never had a debt. We had one building that was, I think we can talk about it now. I don't care. I think our first debt was like $500,000. We were trying to buy the building. Boy, that was a lot of money. And then we went to building debt here for $10 million. And then we bought property on this side for $5 million. Then we built this edifice for $57 or $60 million. And we've never had a church note. And
that's amazing.
I mean, we're not in debt. Yeah. We've had a church note. So God allowed us to always pay it out in front. Why? Because we don't waste money. Now, it's like to whom much is given, much is required. So we don't have to sit in service and hustle people to make them think God won't do it and use tricks.
Teach.
We just use faith to say you are where you are because of what you pay and what you give, not because of what I do. And
that's good.
So that's another thing. If you marry or go into a relationship with someone and money is the object, once they've been paid, now you're sacrificed. But if we're always realizing that he's constantly giving, then you never have to worry about what's coming next. You just go to the next vine.
Let me share this story. It was while we were renovating the church across the street, pulling pews out, laying carpet down, there was a situation. I'm going to let the man remain nameless, where he stole some money from us. What happened, Pastor Rush? And we had to go steal our carpet back. What happened, Pastor Rush?
Yo, you know, that's one of these things about these podcasts. Good Lord. So, yeah, we did. And see all these brothers up front. They got ties on, but we are all really hood for real. So this guy stole, you know, we were working hard trying to renovate our building. The guy stole our carpet. And we have a deacon now, Brother Robinson was working, Sister Orr. They were kind of getting things together. And Brother Robinson is, you know, he Deacon Robinson, but he's so ghetto. But the Lord has changed his life. He's a brand new man now. But this guy stole our carpet, and we found out.
It was a general contractor at the time.
Yeah, contractor. And we found out where, and Dennis Harris was one of those guys in those days. So we found out where it was, and they said, Pastor, what are we going to do? So they told me where the warehouse was. She never heard of this. See, I don't take this stuff home. So one night, the men just decided we're going to have a prayer meeting. And we just got a bunch of trucks together, and we went and prayed at this warehouse. Got into the warehouse, and I don't know how many of y'all ever seen that movie. Was it 48 Hours? Eddie Murphy, when I want to start with this box right here. What is that movie? Beverly Hills Cop. So I went into the warehouse acting like I was some, that's our carpet there. And yes, sir, you move out of the way. So these people got busy, and our guys went and took all of the church carpet. Okay, I'll just break it down. We went and stole our carpet back. And we put all this carpet on people's trucks. Now, that's not the bad part. The bad part is we're coming up 35 and 67. The carpet is hanging off the back. So by the time we got to the church, it was like threads. So we dragging it. It was a mess. But we re-carpeted that church over there. And that was ugly. I didn't want to ever tell that story. But so we went, yeah, broke in a warehouse, stole our church carpet. No, we didn't steal it. We took our church carpet back because they tried to, I don't know what they said. It was just wrong, and I couldn't face the church and say we lost all that carpet.
I love that my pastor is half hood, half holy. I love it. And so when you decided to, the church came together to build this edifice, did you feel like it was too big? You know, you come from Singing Hills. No, we're going to go back. You come from West Dallas Projects. Yeah. To somebody representing West Dallas in the house. Yeah. There it is.
Everywhere.
And so you come from there, from the projects, to this amazing $50 to $60 million building. What was the thought process?
The thought process was for the next generation. We didn't build this church for us. We don't need that. We didn't build this church for the pastor's wing, the wife's wing, the family wing. We didn't build it for celebrities. We built it for those children who are not born yet. Mm. I had a rude, strange awakening to this. My grandson and his friends here, they have shown me models of what this church is what this church is going to look like after we're gone.
They did?
They've already finished it. It's
It's Are you serious? I like to see that. That's amazing.
I don't want to see it again. But no, and it's all blue. I can tell you they got the color scheme. It's blue. It's what they've decided to do with the fish aquariums and all of that. And that could be 20 to 30 years away. And if you don't bless the generation that you're in now, if I died now and I didn't leave this church anything, I was a generational curse to this church. So people can say whatever they need to say. But when I'm gone, there will be a need to do nothing but carry on the work of the Lord. We don't have to hustle anybody. We don't have to start selling drinks and doing weddings in here where people get drunk and start selling alcohol. You don't have to do things like that. You hold on to what God has given you. And that may be outdated and old-fashioned. But when we leave, and we will, and at my funeral, there'll be people down here crying. They better be. And they're going to have a lot of flowers around here. I already picked most of them out. And there'll be pastors in the pulpit, and some of them will have resumes in their hands giving remarks. You know, but we're going to leave here one day. And there will be nothing left to do but continue the work. We don't have to think about what do we sell, how we're going to make it. You teach that. These men that you see now, and these women of God that are here, and the reason we focus on these relationships, the reason we're focusing on telling our story, is because everybody in here right now is still hidden in the picture.
That's beautiful, absolutely beautiful. I want to touch on this, we'll be remiss. In 2021, 2022, you were under a lot of persecution, a lot of accusations. And I always say that the perceived guilt is louder than the innocence. And even though the whole situation was a no-bill situation, Ibach and yourself took a black eye. it gave you angst to even do this podcast, which I salute you for standing in confidence and feeling released by God to actually do this podcast, because you were transparent and said, I just don't want to have all that stuff resurface. And I was like, it would be a disservice to the body of Christ for you to tuck your tail and hide, that God has so much purpose in you still yet to be revealed that, yeah, we just got to talk about it. So when you were facing that, how did you overcome that?
With class. I had to remember that God's eye was always on us. And God wasn't looking to see if I was in the picture. God, to me, was trying to show, do you trust me now that I've blessed you? That was a very hurting thing. And that's why I spoke earlier about love and protect, not show and tell.
Right.
There were a lot of evils done in those things. And I'm going to say this because I guess people that know me know it. I really applaud the people who went out of the way to tell those untruths and to build those. That hurt. And I would love to say, child, it didn't bother me. Yes, it did.
Yeah.
Because I know the people. I know the situations. I know the real stories. I am so grateful that I didn't have to go home and say, well, I got to apologize for something I did. I didn't have to do that.
I want you to say, what did you say to her in that moment? It was something that brought tears down my face. What did you go home and say to her? Do you remember what you told me?
I wish it was you.
No, you didn't.
No, just... Okay, see, that's why people don't take me serious. I'm sorry. Okay, no. No. I remembered when that thing starts, and I'm reading, and I'm like, this is, first of all, this is incredible, because you guys have to remember something. Let's don't play stupid. When people tell lies, there are truths in some of it. Come on, it's just right. Like, you know, In my time, I've had an opportunity, the God-given gift to bless young people, to discipline, raise, encourage. I saw a young man singing up here today, and there's a guy that's in control of the whole song. It's not just one. I could go on and on now. So we've evolved in the way we do things, but if people can look at something and someone can look for monies, you hear me throwing these numbers around?
Like, yeah.
Somebody's
yep.
still listening right now.
Yep.
Like, well, go back and say these. So. First of all, people want you to address things so you can lie about them. I don't have to lie about it. I don't have to address it, because if it's not true, if it's true now, you better address it. Mm-hmm. If it's not true, which lie do you address? So I went home and I just said to her, this is all I said. If you ever wanted to divorce me, this is the best time to do it right now. Mm-hmm. Because if you had to walk away, this right now. And I asked her, do you want to do that? I didn't talk about the falsehood, the dump articles, all the things that were legally 100% proven, 100% proven legally not true.
Right.
No credibility, none of it.
Right.
And so, well, people can say, well, it was written, and people can write another story.
Yeah.
So, but it did expose a lot of people who said, I'll be with you no matter what. Then no matter what came, and it was like, oh, that's cold. So they had to move on, because
right.
they couldn't carry the weight of what was coming next.
Yeah. There it is.
That attack was not about me. That attack was about IBOC showing a standard of standing, because every future church is going to get attacked.
Of course.
So I did ask her that.
What did you say, Sister Beverly?
You know what? Because I knew that wasn't true. I was able to stand with my husband. I am not a weak woman.
Say that again. You're not a what?
I am not a weak woman. You want to try me? Try me. I have had to take stands. But I'm going to stand with him, because I knew that those things were not true. Now, had he done those things, oh, I would have stepped. But I knew those things, they were not true.
That's good. Yeah. That's good.
And I think what was the strongest thing is that it hurt. And again, that's that love and protect. You got to protect.
Yes.
I don't care if he was, well, let them be seen. Imagine what would have happened if someone were able to walk into Walmart, someone accused you of something horrendous, and they know that face.
Yeah.
They don't have to go after you. They go after that face that you publicly put up in front to make yourself look like a real man.
Yeah.
And a real man will do what real men do. You take the hit.
Yeah.
But you don't show them what to come after.
Teach.
They went after my daughter.
Yeah.
They went after our school. They went after this ministry. Yes, I'm saying it out loud now. And I'm not one of these. I'm not a non-classy guy. I'm not this guy. Come on for me. I have too much style for that. I lost a mother. I don't want anybody to lose people. I don't like that. I've heard people say, did it work? Yeah. And I want people to tell people. I want y'all to know that attack worked. It hit me in places. And I woke up. That's why I'm such a strong advocate for children all the time. Because sometimes you guys go on social media and you don't know what that stuff can do to a child who's 7, 8, 9 years old, for someone to misidentify their character, destroy them. I never understood why people would not feel like they needed to live. I have felt that before. Not Ricky Rush, never, yeah.
Absolutely.
It worked, but it didn't prosper. But I want to applaud those. I applaud those, and that's why I said if we ever say this, we have to tell our own story, our own narrative. And I think those of you members that stuck by this church, that's why right now, I don't care if we go to 5 o'clock, people go, we're not here to, we just want to talk to you.
Right.
And those who, this church, this leadership team, oh my God, we never missed a beat. I never missed one day out of the pulpit. I never missed one Sunday. I was doing revivals 3 nights in a row.
Yeah.
to zero people. It happened during COVID. Nobody was in our church. And I don't mean to say things to make people pull that stuff up, please, either. I really don't. But I ask you, as we start our podcast, my podcast, to talk about deciding to try, I had to do that. And the one thing that happened that was so powerful to me is one night, it was early in the morning, because I had a lot of mornings that ran into nights, because I didn't know what to do. I wanted to stand up and fight. I wanted to say, hey, y'all, church, I'm going to go there. Mm-hmm. And the Lord said, do not go to that level. I've proven myself too much to you for you to bring this into that kind of fight. And then God said something that made me a little mad. He said, I love them too.
Yeah.
God wouldn't get mad at the people that hurt me. And so I'm back there again. But I remember one night, and I want you to remember this. This is what happened. It was night, early morning, and I just turned my face to the wall. And all I said was, Jesus, you gotta fix this. That's all I remembered saying. That's all I could say. And then I started watching people who were my friends kind of ask questions like, well, why would somebody say, and then God would like, watch her, watch him, watch her, watch him. Because they are now in the picture and they've been hidden. Sometimes people are not asking you questions to make sure you're all right. They're asking your questions to see if the serum is poisoning you. And I just had to prove to those who wouldn't go away that I'm going to be here when you come back.
Teach. Teach.
But that did hurt. That hurt. That hurt me hard in my heart. It hurt my daughter's career because I had to come to an humbling thing of realizing some people wanted the name and the things that came with Ricky Rush. That was
right.
Great. And when you're up and popping and you're Baskin Robbins, you're the flavor of the month, they want you. But you get older. I'm older now and I'm wiser. And now I am on a comeback physically. And that's why these men are where they are now.
There was a wise pastor that preached a message called Turning Your Setbacks into Comebacks. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound familiar, Pastor?
Yeah, that sounds.
Turning your setbacks into comebacks, which is so powerful. As we get ready to wrap up, there was something that you shared. You and Sister Rush looking at a new home, and you said this to me, and I was in your office and I broke down crying because I never thought that you would even think like this. Can you share that story?
Well, you know, we have a very humble house. And, you know, after COVID and things started going bad, my health was going different. You know, we had to try to find a place to be where they were going to remodel the home and some damage. And we kept putting it off, and I was like, okay, don't want. So then one day, we thought, let's go and look and see, because I know I'm not going to be here long. I mean, always. And I don't want anyone attached to me to be without, because I'm not. So we were looking at this house and this realtor, and I said, looking at it, I wasn't really looking at a house. I'm cool. But the realtor asked me a question at some property, and she said, so why would you want to get a house? I said, ma'am, I'm not really interested. If she wants to find a house, I want, and it wasn't like a she argument, if she wants, I want everything to be whatever she wants. And she said, well, what are your goals and what are your things? And this was just different. I don't think it was different, but maybe because nobody talks like this. I said, one of the reasons I want her to have what she wants is because one day I'm going to die. I'm not going to be here. And I don't want, if I die, for her to have to wonder, or somebody in the church that gets mean decides you got nowhere to go, and they don't want the pastor's family, or that's old, a new pastor comes in and he may not like it. So I want her to have the house she wants, so that if I die, or when I die, she can remarry, live in her dream house, and not have to sacrifice herself anymore, but maybe have a husband that could come home, go to 9 to 5, come home, get what she wants, and not have to think about all these other things. And then if she's not okay with things, she can put him out. So, but at least she needs to know what that kind of normalcy could be. And that doesn't make anybody else feel less or strange, or I don't think it makes me feel like a hero or somebody, but.
No, it's not. It is, though, because most of the times we don't try to make provision for our wives after our demise and have a conversation to say, I want to also make it easier for the next guy that you marry to not feel the burden of finances. When you said that, and you also said you've sacrificed so much, you called on three-way to try to get her to verify. And she's like, I don't want to hear that. You know what I'm saying? Why is it that, which is a tough subject to talk about, why are you so opposed at hearing him speak like that, Sister Rush?
Why am I opposed to
hearing him talk about a life without him?
Oh, because you know what? My relationship with the Lord, it just runs so deep. And one day I'm going to get to tell one of my testimonies. But it runs so deep. And I've already asked the Lord. I said, Lord, I don't want to be left without my husband, because I watched my mom when my dad passed, how she grieved so, because they've been together for so many years. So I asked the Lord to take me first. So I told him, you're not going nowhere. I'm going to be gone. So he didn't have to worry about that. I'll be gone.
You said you didn't know this part?
Now I'm going to look at that house tomorrow. I'm gonna, okay, I got this now. Okay, all right. All right. No, I'm just teasing. But you just have to, you know, I just have learned to be a selfless person. I thank God for growing up poor, because money doesn't move me.
Yes.
I just think, And I just do.
So this is what happened. So this is what really brought me back into Pastor Rush's life on a deep, deep level. Back in April, as he said, Christian works with me. And she sent me a text message. We were supposed to have a meeting with my PR team. And she said, hey, I'm not going to be at the meeting. Papa just passed away. I lost it. I was in Houston. I had a meeting in Houston. I lost it. I was crying uncontrollably. I was messed up. I went to a friend's birthday dinner. I left early because I said, my pastor passed away. And the guilt that I was feeling was back in DC. I had an event in Atlanta and I talked to him. And you know how we tell people, hey, when I get back, we're going to hang out. I'm going to come see you and go out to eat. And I didn't do that. And then here it was April, I get this text message from Christian that needs to learn how to text better, because she's talking about my papa passed away, and I lost it. And so, and I'm texting her, she's not responding, I'm calling her, she's not responding. And so I had to deal with the feeling of Pastor Rush being gone and me not being able to say goodbye. And it hit me hard. A couple of days later, she finally called, and she was like, oh, that's my grandfather, it was my grandfather. I said, what? Why would you say? He said, I don't call my daddy Papa. I said, well, I don't know. Maybe he was grieving and you just text Papa. I don't know. I said, I'm coming to church Sunday. So that Saturday, I came to church. I sat right over there. I was looking at Pastor Rush. I was like, thank you for still being here. I was so messed up. I was devastated. And so I haven't left his hip since then. And that's why I said that day we went to the hospital to go pray for people or whatnot. But I just want to send that as a message, that the people in your life, you never know how long you're going to have them in your life.
Yes.
Make sure that you love on them and you love on them well. Don't take their presence for granted. Say I love you as many times as you can say I love you. Spend those precious times that we are afforded to spend with them. Love on them. And so, Pastor Rush, I'm glad you're still among the living.
Yeah.
Your daughter is, Kate and everybody. The church is happy that you're still here. But yeah, you went through a very, very, very... when I look at you now, it don't even look like you... You know, you always talk about not looking like what you've been through.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Glory to God.
You don't look like what you've been through. You went through a very, very... high-risk surgery, and you're walking, you're laughing, you're still loving on people, still hugging people, you know, still working over at the school. I can't keep up with you. You're always doing way three much. It's not even too much. It's three much at this point. But you're always doing something, and so I just salute you. Did y'all enjoy this episode? Listen, before we conclude, listen, and for my Lit fam, that's the followers that support my podcast. I want y'all to make sure that y'all support Decide to Try, a podcast hosted by the Pastor Ricky G. Rush. That's going to come out probably at the first of the year. It's going to be amazing, absolutely transformative. I'm going to leave a link there in the description so that you can go ahead and subscribe to his YouTube channel so that he can just see all those subscriptions go up to encourage him, because I have to always talk him into doing stuff. He'd be like, I don't know, people may not want to hear from me. People, I was like, you're brilliant. And as y'all saw just in this episode, he dropped so many gems, and Sister Russ dropped so many gems that I hope impacts your life forever. Anything you'd like to say before we close out, both of y'all?
Next. I'm going to sit back in the truck. What I want to say is, and next, we've committed as a church, Brother Whitfield. Now, when he started in this church, and that's why I say, when people see the nature of who we are men, and we build men, and we support and cover our women.
Right.
He started here as a boy, and he would... did his first, I think, first acting scene here.
Yeah, yeah.
And he came on the stage, and it was so funny. The night he was doing this performance, and he had on pajamas. Back in those days, back in the dinosaur, 1995, whenever he...
96, I'm 97?
Like, pajamas, well, now, you know, and because he was looking like, was it Marvin Gaye? I've been really trying to... You know, so it was just cool. And he was very out of the box. the world wasn't ready for him. And the pastor was trying to gain a solid relationship with men. Now that's what he does for a living. My thing is to all of you, you don't have to chase your dreams. Just when you wake up, don't forget that you have a dream.
Teach.
You may run out of energy chasing it, but if you stay where you are, I promise it'll come back around. And that's why we're here. And I don't trust people with this part. I don't want to. That's a choice. I trust God with it. I don't trust people with it. So I want you all to know that he's very sensitive about what this is, so much so that September, I think 25th, 2025? Yeah,
27th.
We're going to probably have the world's largest singles conference from the Dear Wifey podcast that'll be here at IBLC, and we're going to talk about it early because right before that, we'll be celebrating our church anniversary next year in a crazy, wonderful way, moving into this podcast, and I want to publicly commit to having that. And thank you for bringing that platform to IBOC.
Thank you. Yeah.
Because God did not build this building. Back to your question. He didn't just build this building for us. He built this building for the kingdom so that we can now usher things in that are going to be bigger than what people imagine. Nobody builds big anymore because everything is so remote. But yep. It doesn't mean that God still doesn't overflow. All these concerts and things, there's a place for it. Thank you for trusting trusting your gifts and talents in this space. You may not know how many of our enemies that you have taken on today. And I don't know how many of your enemies I've taken on, but I promise all of you that everything that we have done and that we do is always from the heart.
Totally.
Our school, I just want to say, our mission in this church is right across the street. When we were across the street stealing carpet, that was ours. We didn't know that we were bringing, that this would ever be a church building. And from the time of Robert Pauls, Layla Williams, Julia Fuller, Nettie Cox, that are still with us now, and the vision that we have here in this ministry, it started with a few people who had confidence in a guy who didn't even have confidence in himself. I was just following it. So if you've received any hurt from this ministry or any ministry, I publicly apologize. You understand now, we don't hide our families. We cover our families.
Good.
I thank God that I married a person who was humble enough to know who she was. I didn't discover her. That's an insult.
Yeah.
You know, God discovered her. He just gave me a peep at who she is. And there's no way I would have married somebody, AKA. I'm sorry. It just came up. See, I wasn't going pastor. She wasn't going AKA. It was just going to be like, but no, you just don't know what a person's dreams are. And again, don't look at me mad later. I was just playing. No. So, but no, seriously, you just don't know what's going to come in a person's life, okay? And take the relationships you have and marriage enrichment in this church. We're going to take it to a different level because of you. We're going to be virtual with this now.
Yes.
We're not going to say that everybody has to come in the building. We're going to offer it on a different level of technology.
Good.
Thank you for helping me to understand that.
And I want to say this too for the body of Christ. Give your pastors more grace. You know, when you're carrying a mantle that you don't even know what you're carrying, and this is something I had to learn as I matured and as a Christian, is that you have these men trying to figure out the voice of God. They have their wives, their kids, they're juggling two types of homes, their church family and their personal family. And they're not going to get it right every time. I promise you they're not. To carry the weight and the frustrations and the cares and the hurts and the needs and the sickness. Pastor Rush is it's known as an empath, people that carry other people's burdens. And that's what makes him such a solid pastor. And so sometimes we put on men of God as if they are God. God can carry everything, right. But
that's
men can't.
So as a man
of God, he's doing the best he can trying to govern the voice of God, the direction that God has given him. He has all this vision. He has a school across the street that he's doing. He has his hands on everything. I used to say, Pastor Rush, are you extremely controlling? You like to do everything. But I started today. I was sitting there. I said, What if he just enjoys doing what he does?
Yeah.
Could it be that? Could it be that he enjoys directing the choir? Could it be that he enjoys singing the lead to the song that he's directing the choir in?
My leader's quit. No.
And that, he says, lead, quit. But that's the reality. That's what he enjoys. And so we have to give each other the space and the grace to do what they love doing and to grow and make mistakes and still cover it with grace and say, you know what? I see you. I see you. And when you can't have a direct connect to be able to voice your concerns. I used to write Pastor Rush all kind of letters, but I used to write them letters all the time. I wrote the first epistle to Pastor Rush. I would just write letters. But I started learning stuff as I matured. I was like, now I understand it. Now I understand why he moves the way he moves. Now I understand why he acts the way he acts. Now I understand. And a lot of stuff, he didn't even understand what he was doing while he was doing it. I don't know what it's like to carry the weight of a $60 million building. Do y'all know what that feels like? When I closed on my house last year and they told me what the down payment was, I took a nap because I was like, I don't know where I'm getting this from. I don't know what I'm gonna do. But then God gives him this vision. He says, we're gonna do this. And the only way it gets done is through the support and the faith of people, of you, of us. And so now not only are you banking on God, that sounds great. We can have faith in God all day. But when the people stop showing up, those are the people that is going to support the ministry. And so I always say, just level set expectations to understand that when we pray for our pastors, totally pray for our pastors. Would you like to end with anything, Sister Rush?
No, but I just wanted to tell my brothers, I did not forget about you. You know, I love you too. These are my brothers too. I love you guys too.
What I do want to do real quick, you about to say something?
Can I say this real quick? When we hear the stories that people say in ministry, and they said, you know, y'all made it through that, can I tell you how good God is? He didn't let us go through anything. We kept anticipating all this crazy stuff that people were saying, oh, and they're investigating the church. None of that ever happened, period. And I'm thinking, God, get us ready. Can I go, for what? You've crossed that Red Sea. Why are you on this side of it when you're on the other side?
Yeah.
And I just wanted everybody to know that there are things that, you know, you're looking for things, and I'm like, so why didn't you talk about it? We did, but people are not going to write your story,
right? Because
your story doesn't sell. Yeah. It just, and thank you all.
Yeah.
And I can't say anything more than thank you. We take our hats off to you. We lift our hands to God for you.
Yeah.
And help me be who I need to be for you every day by helping each other.
Well, y'all give it up for this dynamic couple, Pastor Ricky G. Rush and Sister Beverly Rush.
You just witnessed the wonderful, excellent, awesome 34th Church Anniversary podcast that we decided to do here to just bring you into the reality of the good times, the struggles, and the blessings of the Inspiring Body of Christ Church. I want to thank Brother Lateris Whitfield. I want to thank our super special guest, Sister Beverly Rush, today. And I want to thank all of you. Now, right now, what we're doing is our tithes and offering period. And I just wanted to personally come along and thank you, those of you that are in this city, this state, but even outside of this country, right? Thank you for giving your tithes and your offerings and being a blessing to us. A very happy good morning to Sister Simone, Germany. Wow, that's amazing. So I'm here because, well, this is no game. This is for real. 34 years now, you know, the enemy's been chasing us for a long time. But we will not be defeated. Thank you. Old school candy, old school games, old school IBLC.
Whew, what a time we had. Thank you for joining us to receive God's word at IBLC. As we move forward in 2024, we stand on the word of God with a mindset that says, as they went, they were healed. Our prayer is that something was said or something was done in this service that will encourage you in your relationship with God. If you're ever in the Dallas area, nothing can compare to being a part of a live IBLC service. Our inspiring, dynamic Sunday morning service begins at 10 a.m. And if you're looking for even more practical teaching from the Word of God, join us every Monday at 7 p.m. for Monday School, where it's all about simplicity. Now, if you can't experience the joy in person, you can view all of our services on our Facebook pages, our YouTube channel, or our church website at ibocchurch.org. Make sure that you like and subscribe to all of our social media platforms for pictures, videos, information about our church, our pastor, our world-famous aquariums, our amazing school, the University of Dreams at IBOC, and so much more. As a matter of fact, you can access all of these platforms on one easy link tree by texting the words Pastor Rush to the number 31996. Finally, family, we want to thank you for supporting this ministry with your prayers and your financial gifts. When you give to IBOC, you're giving to a church full of integrity that stands on the Word of God. You can give whenever and wherever you want on the Givelify app, the Cash app, or via text to give. Don't forget to name your seed and believe God for your harvest. Well, that's all we have for today, family. We want to thank you for learning with us. Thank you for growing with us. We're on a mission to win more souls to Christ. So let God use you today to inspire someone else. Enjoy God's blessings, family. And remember, all the glory goes to God.